The city of Portland is defined by the Willamette River. With more access points and greatly improved water quality, more and more Portlanders are interacting with the river, revitalizing the city's lost river swimming culture. But a growing threat, driven by climate change and other pressures, could reverse that progress. At Ross Island Lagoon, a remnant of the wild riverway at the edge of downtown Portland, toxic algae blooms are on the rise, spilling into the river and flowing through the city. This is the story of Ross Island Lagoon, its toxic threat, and those working to solve the problem and keep the Willamette River safe and resilient in the face of global change.
We are out at the Ross Island Lagoon today collecting water quality and hydrodynamic data. So we're trying to understand what's happening with the hydraulics out here and how that connects to harmful cyanobacteria. So we're trying to understand what sort of drives them to become these big blooms that turn the whole lower river green, and then what we can do to try to help knock that back and suppress them.
I just feel that water brings out the best in people. The Willamette is our liquid public space. It's our blue space. So when you're talking about an urban environment and having relief from the built environment, being able to tap into our second largest public space, a natural area, is huge. There's no higher metric of livability for me than being able to get on your bike, ride to the river, and take a swim in the summertime.
Yeah, I think that biking in general is just about accessing nature and being a part of the city. And so it really goes hand in hand with like being able to, you know, use and connect to the river too.
It's just really accessible. And so for me, like I take advantage of it, definitely during the warm months, at least once or twice a week.
Do you really get to like sit here and like be, you know, connected with the river, and I think that that's really important for our mental health.
Rivers were really viewed as sacred. They were the source of life. I mean, you probably have heard the phrase, water is life, and you know, rivers represent that.
The Willamette River is a treasure in Portland, and for a pet owner to be able to spend the day down at the river is something that we truly cherish. A day out at the river should not be lethal to your dog or mean a trip to the emergency room. And these harmful algae blooms are deadly.
Well, the harmful algal bloom threatens to derail decades of progress towards making the lower Willamette River this equitable, freely available resource for the city.
During the summer, I'm down at the river pretty regularly, and so it has become more routine for me to check on the status of algae bloom. And certainly, you know, if it is present, I don't go there.
So Ross Island got on our radar, I think because it kind of checks more than the boxes of just climate change and water temperature. So you have the water path modification as well as the industrial use of it and the ramifications of that, and then the higher temperatures and low flows, which then will trigger the harmful algae blooms. So it's the whole Columbia system kind of in a microcosm of the threats that can go wrong.
This is a complicated problem, but it is solvable, and it is not an option not to solve it.
So Ross Island was actually multiple islands, as I'm sure you know, and we're just at the north end or the downstream end. The Willamette is flowing another umpteen miles or so onto to meet the Columbia. And the Willamette platform was anchored, and you'll see it in the photographs, it's anchored just off the north end of Ross Island. And Willamette was a floating platform. It was right here, had a hole in the middle that was like a tank. but it wasn't an enclosed tank. It was basically just a hole. You know, swimming was like the happening thing in the summertime. It's what Portland did during the summer is they swam, and they swam here. Because of increased sewage buildup and health concerns in the Willamette River 100 years ago, the summer of 1924, required people to no longer swim in the river. There was so many people who really, their form of recreation was swimming in the Willamette. It was a real body blow.
Portland lost generations of river swimmers before addressing the problem of sewage and beginning to restore the river's reputation. Now, summer blooms of harmful cyanobacteria pose risks to water quality, wildlife, fish, dogs, and all those who use the river. But a chance meeting between an Oregon State University water resource engineer and a Portland River activist has led to a solution.
So we have a river hunter swim team, and in 2014, I got off the dock and a gal came up to me and said, hey, I don't know if it would be helpful, but I teach classes in river engineering at Oregon State University and we work on real world solutions to river engineering problems. I found it very charming that Dr. Telos offered that. It was beyond comprehension how I'd ever be able to utilize that nice offer. So we were getting ready to do the big float in 2015, and I got a call from Oregon Health Authority and Department of Environmental Quality saying that there was a harmful algae bloom in the Ross Island Lagoon. I had no idea what a harmful algae bloom was at that point, and I'm informed that if the harmful algae bloom is toxic, that it can kill dogs, it can make people sick. This is something people have been aware of for the last 20 years, but no one has done anything about it. I found Dr. Telos' contact information, said, hey, how do you feel about the Ross Island Lagoon? Remember our conversation? She said, you know, yeah, we'll check it out. So we engaged Oregon State University to come out to do a baseline study of the hydrology of the lagoon. The students, Dr. Telos, basically concluded that Ross Island Lagoon is a 140-acre pond inside of a river. It's stagnant, it's a harmful algae blooming factory. And that was really the beginning of our work with Oregon State University.
Well, we needed science first to be able to understand what drives the bloom. Was it driven by nutrients? Was it driven by light? Was it driven by the stagnant water condition? And what we've come to understand is those are all important, but of the things that we can control, the stagnant water and the temperature are the two things we have the greatest opportunity to influence. Historically, the Ross Island Lagoon was three islands. And in the 20s, the Corps of Engineers came in and built an embankment in the upstream end. And they really did that to increase access between the islands. And that completely shut off flow between the islands. And then subsequently, a private gravel operator came in and extracted millions of cubic meters of gravel. And really, a lot of that was what downtown Portland was built on. But it created this big hole in the river. So it's 120 feet deep at its deepest. And those conditions really have created a stagnant pool in the middle of a flowing river. So those are the perfect conditions for cyanobacteria to bloom. Those bacteria occur here naturally, but we've created conditions in the river where they outcompete some of the other more desirable algae. And that's a problem because when they bloom, when you've got this overgrowth of algae, they produce toxins, and those toxins can kill dogs, they can make people sick. And so it has real human health impacts. It also impacts the ecosystem. The lower Willamette used to be a really important place on the migratory pathway for salmon and other anadromous fish that make their way between the ocean and fresh water. Used to be a really wide, diverse floodplain. A lot of that's disappeared, and so there's only these few remnants that are left, and Ross Island is one of them. But in the summer, when those harmful algal blooms occur, the water quality conditions are really poor. So it's really not a hospitable place for fish currently. If we can treat this bloom, we can sort of restore both access to that physical habitat and the quality for fish. We've spent several years collecting data to understand the site, developing engineering plans, developing models. And what's clear is that the best solution from a sustainability perspective, from an effectiveness perspective, is to restore flows through the lagoon. So reset ecological processes here with what we're considering calling a flushing channel. So the idea is that where that historical embankment was that the Corps of Engineers built so long ago, we essentially cut a notch through it and let flow move back through with the lagoon again. It eliminates the stagnant water. It creates conditions where the cyanobacteria can't really outcompete the other more desirable algae, and so kind of resets things the way closer to where they used to be historically, which will help suppress the cyanobacteria.
The ultimate goal isn't to like engineer a solution, it's to undo inappropriate engineering solution.
The science is everything. I think a big part of the reason that no one had the initiative to start this is that it is super complicated. The more we bring the science along, the easier it is to engage in that.
So this partnering with the community, it's something that OSU's been doing for a long time. We reach out to the public to understand what their needs are and really start to build the science around what problems we're trying to solve on the landscape.
Guided by research, we now have a roadmap on how to create a data-driven solution to a problem that affects the health of the Willamette River and the quality of life of the people who live near it. The public support and partnerships forged to reach this point will be essential to transform the science-based designs into reality.
At Oregon Humane Society, we are grateful for the opportunity to collaborate with these other agencies to help look for permanent, sustainable solutions to making the Willamette River a safe place for people and their pets.
As a city, we have so many competing priorities, and the river is such a constant, but it's really important that we don't take it for granted and think about, you know, how do we preserve it for generations to come.
It's a chance to restore what was there before. I feel like with this project, we're on the front lines of climate change. My hope is that for young people, seeing that we did have the guts to try to take this thing on, that we will fix it, that there are some things that are fixable.
When it gets hot, people who don't have resources can't just drive out of the city to cool off. It's this great resource for people to connect with each other and with nature.
We can clean up the Willamette River, not just for humans, but also for salmon and other wildlife as well.
Tribal teaching is that the creation gave up their voice for humans when humans came, but out of that came an obligation that we have to speak on their behalf because they can't. And, you know, that's true for every, we all have that obligation.